whatever this is. And thank you for joining us for today's lecture on commercialization. So today with us, we have John Dick, Dr. John Dick. He is the business advisor for the Velocity Incubator, specializing in the commercialization of scientific research. He's also a graduate of the Velocity Incubator program from 2016. He holds a PhD in materials science from Imperial College London, which he obtained in 2012, as well as a master's of engineering from McGill, where he studied work in nanotech-enabled biosensors. He also has his master's, his MBA from Laurier, obtained just last year in 2020. Congratulations. He's the former chief scientific officer as well as the co-founder of Nicoya Life Sciences, a company he founded in 2012. Which specializes in benchtop surface plasmon resonance tools for biomolecular characterization and measurement. I almost got that out without breaking it. And today he's going to be discussing how to get things from concept to market and the realities of commercializing your research. Without further ado, John, take it away. For the record, any questions can feel free to be put in the chat or the Q&A. We'll be post those as they come up and we'll get to them all by the end. Take it away, John.
Great. Thank you very much, John. Thank you for that great introduction. And thanks to Kaylee and Kimberly for inviting me to speak today. And thanks to all of you for coming in. I hope you find this informative. So as was mentioned, my name is John Dick, and I'm a business advisor with the Velocity Incubator. And I'm here to speak to you about the commercialization of your scientific research. So a little bit about me. I earned my bachelor's, master's of engineering at McGill University. I left there in 2007. After that, I pursued my PhD at Imperial College of London, where my focus was on the creation of nanoparticle-based biosensors for enzyme activity quantification. I graduated there at the end of 2011, beginning 2012. Afterwards, I came home to Canada, where I attended the 2012 Nano Ontario Conference that was hosted at the brand new QNC building at Waterloo University. And while I was there, I met a guy named Ryan who was giving a talk about the company he had just incorporated based on his master's work in localized surface plasmon resonance, or LSPR. And LSPR happens to use gold nanoparticles to detect proteins, which sounded very familiar to me. So we chatted a little bit after the talk, and I started working for Nicoya the following week as a co-founder. And, when we got our start, we took advantage of a lot of the programs that are here in KW for startups like ours. We were at the Accelerator Center, and we became the first team hosted by the then Velocity Science Program, which is now called the SIH, the Science Innovation Hub. And once we grew large enough, we graduated from those programs and moved out on our own in 2016. And then after 7 years of working at Nicoya, I decided to pursue other interests. So I took my MBA at Laurier, and that was just last year. And now I'm a business advisor for Velocity, where I help early stage teams navigate the same processes that we did back in 2012. So here's a picture of me in 2012 when I started Nicoya, and there's a picture of me just after I left. And I think it's clear the difference that 7 years working at a startup makes. Neckties go out of style, I think. So a little bit about Nicoya's early story, just because I think that's probably what you guys are most interested in. So we managed to take our lab-based research and turn it into a product and built a company around it. So as I mentioned before, LSPR uses biofunctionalized gold nanoparticles to measure binding kinetics between proteins. And as we first pitched the technology as a solution for at-home monitoring of congestive heart failure patients. And congestive heart failure is a chronic condition where the heart has been damaged and is unable to circulate blood adequately throughout the body. Various drugs and careful water intake and careful fluidic intake are needed to manage the condition, which can easily become unbalanced if it's not monitored properly. And we found in a few papers, we found a blood biomarker that could potentially be used to monitor the condition of a patient and allow the doctor to make dosage changes remotely and thus prevent hospital visits or regular hospital visits. So that all sounds good, right? That you know, as a problem solution fit that fits a nice narrative. But in the end, you know why we chose congestive heart failure? In the end, it was because of all the chronic conditions out there, it was the largest market and the biggest problem, and thus could get the most attention towards us. And we sort of glossed over, in those early days, we sort of glossed over the fact that LSPR is more suitable for quantifying protein binding interactions, but not really quantifying protein concentrations. You know, we kind of just said, well, those are details we'll work out later. But, you know, and the story was pretty good. You know, we were pitching well, winning competitions, which gave us a lot of free money that we could pour back into the business. So it really kept us afloat. And as we moved on, we went to conferences where we were pitching and we were meeting with doctors and we were meeting with people into space. And they are loving our solution. They're really supportive. And we thought this was great. We thought this was like validating our idea. We thought we were really onto something. And then we met some doctors from the University Health Network, UHN in Toronto, that worked directly with congestive heart failure patients. And they loved our stuff too. They thought it was great. And then they invited us to actually come to their clinics and meet some of the patients. And it was meeting those patients that we first started to realize that our solution may not fit the problem. We found that most of the patients were quite elderly. Many of them had comorbidities that would prevent them from reliably taking daily blood samples, inserting them into a machine, which is what our design had called for. So we started to question, okay, maybe this solution doesn't fit. And we are also starting to run out of money with a lot of research left to do. So thankfully we spoke to an advisor and we asked, and he asked, you know, what did we have so far? And at that time we had a repeatable sensor design and we had a setup for measuring protein binding that we had used all the way for our research. And then he asked a brilliant question now in retrospect, well, you know, can you sell that? Can you just sell the sensor and instrument setup? And so we hadn't thought of that. And we started researching the scientific instrumentation market and found out that yes, indeed, there was a gap in the market for a low cost SPR instrument like we had built. That our competitors sold instruments for six figures and we could sell ours for about 10 times less than that and still make a decent profit. So this led to our pivot. So then, you know, we went from being a medical device company to a scientific instrumentation company. And luckily for us, our new target market was university professors, and we happened to be in a location where we could have access to a lot of university professors. So we started talking to them as our new customers. And we found out what they needed in terms of features for the product and what kind of price point they could afford. And then we went on to sell a dozen beta instruments. And that was enough traction that we could attract some seed investments. We managed to raise our first round of funding, our seed round, for $750,000. And that was about 3 years after we had started and we had formed a company. And the story beyond that, you know, I'll just take you through it quickly. We, you know, our first logo is up here in the corner and switched to this more new logo later on. In the middle here, this is me, this is Ryan, this is Sean. We are the co-founders. You know, that was the team from 2013 to 2015 until we finally got that seed funding and we could finally afford to hire a few more people. This photo here was taken in 2019. And that is only half the size of what the company is now in 2021. So you can see that the growth is exponential. This is a picture of the Accelerator Center where our first office was located. We also located at Velocity. This is the Bomer Box factory, which is located beside the Google building in Kitchener, if you know it. Kind of a rundown building, but it got the job done until finally we moved into our own building, which is now located on King Street in downtown Kitchener. This is our product, our first product. The Open SPR is literally a piece of sheet metal that we bent to form a box and painted and put our instrumentation inside. We sold, you know, 200 of these as our original design. over several years, and then eventually upgraded to this design down here, which looks much more like an instrument that I'm sure you'd be used to seeing in one of your labs. And then this is the newest instrument that they've created, the alto, that's been launched and due to start shipping next year. So, you know, over time, things can really change and really pick up. So to bring me back to, or bring us all back to what we want to talk about in terms of commercializing research. So say you're back in your lab and you have an idea, you've done some research, you've created a few papers. Now what do? You think you have something you want to commercialize, now what you do? Well, this is one of my papers from back in the day, and an example of the kind of market validation that goes into a lot of these papers I thought would be kind of fun to pull out. So usually in the first one or two paragraphs, you write a short little blurb about how your research can be used in the real world. And in my case, our assay here could be used for breast cancer diagnosis. And I wrote this little blurb in red here that, you know, breast cancer is very commonly occurring, that early detection is necessary, and, you know, that we need new assays for early detection of cancer. You know, and that's great. Did much thought or research go into that? No. You know, I think we just found a few things, like, you know, the design of the assay was a more important thing than its use case down the road. So definitely didn't do much validation there. But that all being said, if I was so inclined, I could take this paper, this idea, I could build a pitch deck around it, enter it into a competition, and likely do very well, claiming that this technology could reduce breast cancer mortality rates and the cost savings that could come with it. I could claim all that, and I wouldn't necessarily be lying, you know, that is potentially out there, but nothing has been de-risked at this point. It's still just an assay that I developed in a lab under extremely favorable conditions, and you know, just because I convinced a few people at a pitch competition that this could work, does that mean it could actually work? And the truth is, you know, I don't know. You know, but probabilities would suggest that no, and it's that current state, it probably wouldn't work for any of 100 reasons, both scientific and commercial and business. So the whole, you know, so my point is that you don't really know if you have a viable solution to a problem until you start talking to people, and those people are not in your lab and they are not usually at your school. You have to get outside those places in order to really get the information you need to find out if your idea is one that could be commercialized and really feasible. And this brings us to a bunch of, you know, misconceptions. So, because this idea of customer validation seems to be a sticking point for a lot of researchers, and something that comes up with a lot. And I've seen researchers bend over backwards to try to come up with reasons not to talk to customers, and I'm not sure why. And there's really no way around it. So one of the biggest misconceptions I've heard is, I will design the product so well that I won't even need to sell. Customers will just come to me. And my response to that is, well, how will you design that perfect product if you don't speak to customers to find out what they need? You know, you can't. So, you know, so you need to find them and start talking to them. And not only that, they'll make your product better. They'll help you design it. And you know, and they'll likely buy it when it's ready. So you want to get out there and speak to customers. Another one I hear is, my product must be perfect before I put it out in front of customers. I hear this in a lot from engineers especially. And my response to that is just most feedback comes from early adopters who test your product. So those early customers are the people who test your product and give you feedback. And, you know, it's impossible at a startup stage for you to test your product to perfection internally and you know, maintain, you know, and do so in a timeline that will prevent you from going out of business and running out of money. So you should know that early adopters are very forgiving, and you can always take care of them after the fact. All of our beta users, we gave them free versions of our, you know, of the final version of our product, just to say thanks for being with us through the start. So, you know, early adopters help you with these things. And usually when somebody is fearful of putting out a product that's less than perfect, it's the fear talking more than any pragmatic thinking. The next one is, everything I need to know about the market can be found by reading a reputable report. And this is an illusion. You can find, for sure, you can find a lot of macroscopic market data in a report, you know, and it will provide you valuable information that you'll need on things like trends and potential market size and growth in that market. But it won't tell you how to make your first sale. It won't tell you who's going to give you that first dollar for, you know, for solving their problem. And that can only come from speaking with customers. So keep that in mind. Another one I've heard is, I can hire a consultant to do market validation for me. And no, you can't. You as a co-founder, as a founder of this company, you need to get to know your customers intimately. And you have to gain firsthand knowledge of their problems. And really, no one else can do that but you. And then finally, going back to what I kind of mentioned before, I've won a bunch of pitch competitions, so I have a validated market. And no, that's not true. Some judges with no expert knowledge in your space may like your idea, but that doesn't mean it's validated. Even people in the industry that you're trying to sell into may say they love your product. That's what happened with the doctors and Nicoya. They thought the idea was great. But it's really the customers, it's the end users who will give you the real information. So those are the people you need to find and talk to. I hopefully haven't turned you off too much about the commercialization of scientific research. So after all of these mistakes I've made, after all these trials and tribulations, is it worth it? And yes, yeah, absolutely, it's worth it. There are many, many similarities between entrepreneurs and researchers. They have many of the same skills. I mean, a research at heart is a problem solver. You define your topic of research, the problem, and you make a hypothesis and then you experiment until you find a solution. And this is what's done in growing a business. A business plan doesn't happen naturally. It happens through experiment. You don't know how to get your product in front of customers, how to sell it, and you don't know what distribution channels are going to be effective. You don't know how much you should charge. So you guess, you make a hypothesis, and then you test it and until you find something that works. And how do you test it? Well, you take it to customers and you speak to them. And then finally, a startup requires a monumental amount of work. That's all on your own schedule. There are typically no deadlines other than the ones you set for yourself. So that's much like research. So you must be self-motivated and you must be hardworking. And finally, one thing to watch out for, because you're commercializing research, just the nature of this situation, your product idea will be inherently a solution in search of a problem. And you may hear this quite often, solution in search of a problem. This isn't necessarily a bad thing. Like, this happens to everybody. It happened to us. We had a low-cost LSPR set up. We thought it could be used as a medical device. It turned out in solving that problem, but it turned out it could be used as, you know, something for academics to use in a lab. So you should know that applying what you've created in your lab will take some adjustments to fit a use case in the real world. You'll have to be prepared to put time and effort into learning about that real world use case, the problem, and adjusting your solution to fit it. I can use an example. Since we're in the IQC, quantum computers. It's taken years for quantum computers to find a use case. Everyone's talking about them being used from everything from code breaking to drug discovery, still are talking about them in those ways. But the latest thing I've heard as a first use case for them is Wall Street using them for banking, which is just so typical. But that also illustrates how business and markets really drive that problem solution fit. You know, it really works that way and not the other way around. So if I haven't totally you know, turned you off the idea of commercializing your research, what can you do, or what are the next steps? So my suggestion would be to use the campus resources. There's so much that we have here available to you. If you need to do more problem analysis, if you need, you know, if you have that solution in search of a problem kind of situation, we have groups on campus that are designed just to look into that. So check out the Zero Experience, which is run by a couple of guys who are just brilliant and fantastic. That runs every term at the beginning of each term. Really, really great program around how to use innovative thinking, and you can certainly apply it to any company. It's a great program. Otherwise, there's also Problem Lab that has people you can meet with that are experts in problem analysis and what can help you walk through how you define your problem, how you go about certifying that it's a real problem for people. If you happen to be working in environment or social innovation, there's the Greenhouse, which will take you through that whole process as well, that whole problem analysis solution fit process. If you are creating a startup, Concept is a great place for you to go. We have the intro sessions and workshop sessions that will teach you all of the things you need to know about starting a company and all of the different factors to consider. We also have the Concept 5K competition, which you can enter in order to kind of get some scrutiny on your idea and get some feedback from knowledgeable judges. And you might win 5K in the end if it turns out you've got a really good situation there. There's also the Concept Coaches, which are all people that have done this before. Many of them have commercialized their research coming out of the university, out of UW, and are currently in the Velocity Incubator. So they're a fantastic resource, and you can talk to them about any topic whatsoever. And then finally, there's the Concept Translation Program, which is what I'm in charge of, and that's coming out next term. I just launched a pre-incubator program, and the program is going to be very similar, but the translation program is going to be skewed for specifically grad students and their professors who want to commercialize their research. And we will be taking you through exactly what I'm talking about, customer discovery and validation processes. Finally, if you are interested in pursuing a more academic route towards entrepreneurship, there are Conrad courses and MBET courses that you can take that can help you if you work best in an academic environment, we'll say. And with that, that is the conclusion of my talking bits. I'm going to just leave this slide up because it has the resources available, but I'm happy to take any questions that you might have.
All right. Thank you so much, John, for that. That was really interesting. So as mentioned, it's kind of open for questions. If anyone has any questions, feel free to unmute or write it in the chat. So I guess I'll get things started. You mentioned one thing that you mentioned earlier that kind of like caught my attention was like, you mentioned that, you know, they have a drive to like make sure our product is perfect. The product doesn't have to be perfect, but like, how good does it have to be? At what point are we just frustrating the potential end users?
Well, it has to work, right? So there's a concept called the minimal viable product, MVP, that has been popularized in Silicon Valley and fits with what we're talking about here. In your customer conversations, you are actually looking not for the features that they want, you're looking for the features they need. And you're trying to get to market as quickly as possible, because that's how you get revenue, that's how you get traction, that's how you get investment, if you need investment. So what you're actually looking for are the minimal sets of requirements and features that you would require for your that are required for your product, and you build that. And as long as that works for the customer, it may not work for all of them, they might not be completely happy with it, but it is something that you can sell and that will make you money. And then you add those features on in future designs. So the whole idea of, and it's a great question because it goes into this idea of perfection, is that you can create, you know, a product that's good enough, and then you're like, oh, but just one more feature, this one customer wanted that, so I'm gonna add this feature, which will take another couple months, and then there's always one more feature that you can add to just make it more perfect. but you have to sell it at some point. So really what you're trying to do is trying to limit the features to what is absolutely necessary for your customers to buy and enjoy.
Okay. We have a question from Vincent Russo. Are any of these resources available for UW alumni, not just current students?
I'm assuming you're not a postdoc. So if you're not a postdoc, you're not an alumni, you're not a current employee, I do not think that they are available, unfortunately. Now, if you do email me, and I'll put my email in the chat at the end of this, I will see if I can help you. If you have a good idea, I can help you out and see what resources we have for you.
Okay. We have a question from Shihan. You advise to talk to customers when you're kind of knee deep in the lab. Customers don't just come walking in the door. So how do you start making those connections? How do you find those folks?
Yeah, it's a good question. So it's really your network in the end. It's a lot of digging online. It's a lot of Googling, probably cold calling, cold emails. But you expand your network out into the customer space that you are searching for. There's no trick about it. There's no like magic wand that you can wave that will land you in amongst a bunch of customers. Really, it's just using your network, talking to people who know people, and building your bridge out to where the customers are and then talking to them. And then once you're there, building that network out from that point.
Shihan says, thanks. I think that might be the last of the questions we have in the chat. So, I mean, it's time to sneak in a quick one. If anyone's, worried about the recording being on, we'll shut off the recording in just a second. We can kind of go free after that. But before we do that, I'd like to thank John again for chatting with us tonight. It was a lot of fun.
Great. Thank you for having me.